Penguin Random House Audio presents This Hallelujah Banquet, How the End of What We Were Reveals Who We Can Be, by Eugene H. Peterson. Read for you by Fred Sanders. Editor's Note: This Hallelujah Banquet was created primarily from a sermon series that Eugene H. Peterson preached at Christ Our King Presbyterian Church in Bel Air, Maryland, during Lent in 1984, along with wider commentary and materials from his personal archives. We at Waterbrook have selected and edited this material to read smoothly, while remaining faithful to Eugene's unique voice and pastoral intention. Our edits and additions have been limited. Besides correction of minor errors and some reordering for flow and clarity, the only changes have been to remove dated references to technology, politics, pop culture, and so forth, replacing those with the principles Eugene was making, and to add related material from other works on Revelation in places where additional context is helpful in a printed setting. For example, much of the opening chapter of the book, which gives valuable insight into Eugene's thoughts on John's ministry to the churches of Revelation, and our need to return to these words of Christ through John, came from a much earlier 1967 sermon. As well, we occasionally have inserted a few especially profound insights from his later writings on Revelation in places where they fit naturally with his earlier preaching. We have strived to take no unnecessary liberties with Eugene's words or thoughts, and to present them to you with the craft and care that Eugene exercised in writing and preaching them. Speaking personally, as I have worked, I have noted with pleasure the special intimacy that comes from words meant to be spoken. I think Eugene would have smiled to see his sermons still preaching after so many years of Sundays. A final structural note. Each of the letters follows a similar outline. First, Christ presents a particular part of his character. Next, Christ examines the Christians. The examination reveals both strengths and weaknesses, and so corrective action is commanded. An urgent promise concludes each message. Far from a wooden devotion to this approach, Eugene honors its rhythm in each of the chapters. In these messages, we are confronted with how the end of one way of life, or even one version of our faith, can usher in a new and more vibrant connection with Christ. Every ending can become a beginning. It is this theme of examination and invitation that forms the core of Eugene's teaching in this book. When this book was first pulled together in the fall of 2019, we had no idea of the global changes that would come with the widespread pandemic of 2020. Now, as it releases at the beginning of a misty 2021, a sober attentiveness has come. More than any time in living memory, it has felt for many like the end of the world. With that have come grief, reflection, and hope, all of which are present in these pages. It's with quiet joy and expectation that we at Waterbrook, with the blessing of Eugene's family, present this special book to you. May it lead you to a deeper knowledge of the Lamb, who invites us all to his eternal feast, to this rich and timely Hallelujah Banquet. Paul J. Pastor, Editor. Beginning at the End. He who sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the fountain of the water of life without payment. He who conquers shall have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." Revelation chapter 21, verses 5 through 7. The end is where we start. The last book of the Bible, Revelation, has some of the best words to start the year, words that launch us into the pages of our calendars. T.S. Eliot wrote in Little Gidding, "What we call the beginning is often the end, and to make an end is to make a beginning. The end is where we start from." The end is where we start from. The end of the Bible is the beginning of our New Year's existence. It functions for us in this way as it speaks to our mood and condition. The characteristic mood, the typical mental stance on New Year's Day, is a look to the future. We have a calendar of unused days stretching out before us. There is curiosity about them and fear of them. Amateur prophets make predictions. Astrological magazines and horoscope plotters are in their peak season. Articles proliferate in magazines and newspapers. The business outlook, the literary prospects, the political probabilities, the social changes expected. And with all this, no one can avoid these personal questions. What will it bring for me? What waits to be recorded in the diary pages of the new year? The book of Revelation is the word of God that speaks to this combination of anxiety and hope about the future. For the person who is concerned with the future, the book of Revelation is the timely word of God. In the course of our years, New Year's Day is a day wherein our concern about the future is expressed. The book of Revelation is the part of Scripture that deals with our concern about the future. When we begin reading the book of Revelation, we are first confused and then disappointed. We are confused by an author who talks of angels and dragons, men eating books, and giant insects eating men, bottomless pits and mysterious numbers, fantastic beasts and golden cities. The language confuses us. And then we are disappointed because we don't find what we are looking for. We want to know what is going to happen in the future, but we find neither dates nor names. We are fearful of what may happen to the world in the next 12 months, but we don't find anything said that helps us understand the coming days. We have some hopes for our lives and for our families, but we find nothing that is said about our prospects. We go back to reading the political analysts and working the horoscope in the paper, escaping occasionally with a science fiction novel and making do as best we can. So what has happened? Has the book of Revelation, a holy scripture notwithstanding, failed us? Is the word of God, though highly regarded in previous centuries, quite inadequate to communicate to our adult, mature world? We put the writer and reader of Revelation in a class with palm readers and fortune tellers. Colorful, but chancy. Or is it that we just haven't given it enough thought? Maybe what is needed is some hard concentration to figure out the symbols, arrange the chronology, and pin down the predictions. Many people have done just that. Obsessed with the future and unwilling to concede that the Bible does not have the final word on it, they twist and arrange the material in it until it finally does yield the word they want to hear. History becomes arranged in prophetic installments. Dates are set and personalities named. The future is known. There is no more uncertainty. But the end result, satisfying as it is not recognizable in the book of Revelation. Maybe this book doesn't need ingenuity as much as open attention. Maybe we have been so obsessed with questions about the future that we haven't heard what Revelation said about it. Maybe we have so fixed in our minds the kind of thing that will be said that we are not able to hear what is actually said. For us, the future means dates, events, and names. And if we do not find them, we either give up in disgust or invent them and put them in anyway. Maybe, though, the future does not mean that at all. Maybe God is trying to say something in the book of Revelation that we haven't thought about before that is the truth about the future. Maybe this is a new word, a really new word. This new, unexpected quality is characteristic of Scripture. Have you noticed how often people question Jesus in the gospel narrative, and how regularly his answer ignores their question? Scripture is not an encyclopedia of information to which we go when we are curious or in doubt. It is God speaking to us his own word, telling us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.